hurt by that. He could be still there. Sort of a hellraiser, and he don't know exactly what he wants. I think, but he's the most dangerous thing to the present regime. I think if he were to take over, he'd ask us to get out. And of course, we did. Under our theory of standing by self-determination of people, I don't see how we can say we're not going to go. Charlie Beans and Charlie the government. The thing is, it's going to be a headache to anybody that tries to fool with it. Now, you've got all the brains in the country, Mr. President. You better get hold of them. I don't know what to do about this. I saw it all coming on, but that don't do any good now. There's water over the dam, under the bridge, and we're there,
Well,
you've got over there, McNamara. He was up here testified yesterday for the committee. I didn't want to have him up here, but Howard Cannon, some of them want to have him. So I set up here in 8:30 before I start the appropriation hearings. He's got he's been kicked around on it so well. I'm not sure he's as objective as he ought to be in surveying the conditions out there. He feels like it's sort of present up to him personally to see that the thing goes through, and he's a can-do fella. But I'm not too sure he understands the history and background of those people out there as fully as he should. But even from his picture, the damn thing ain't getting any better, and it's getting worse. And we're putting more and more in there, and they're taking more and more away from the people we're trying to help that we give them. I don't know, so you better get some brains from somewhere to apply to this thing, and I don't know what to do with it.
Well, I spend all my days with Rusk and McNamara and Bundy and Harriman and the Vance and all those folks that are dealing with it, and I would say that it pretty well adds up to them now that we've got to show some power and some force, and that they do not to believe, they're kind of like MacArthur in Korea, they don't believe that the Chinese communists will come into this thing, but they don't know, and nobody can really be sure, but their feeling is that they won't, and in any event, that we haven't got much choice, that we are treaty bound, that we're there, that this will be a domino that will kick off a whole list of others, and that we've just got to prepare for the worst. Now, I have avoided that for a few days. I don't think the American people are for it. I don't agree with Morse and all he says, but
it doesn't look to me. He's forcing the sentiment of a hell of a lot.
I'm afraid that's right. I don't think the people of the country know much about Vietnam, and I think they care a hell of a lot less.
I know, but you go to send a whole lot of our boys out there.
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly right. That's what I'm talking about. You get a few. We had 35 killed, and we got enough hell over 35 this year. So
that many, more than that, have been killed in Atlanta, Georgia, been killed this year in automobile accidents. Okay?
That's right, and 83 went down in one crash on a 707, but one day, but that didn't make any difference there.
That's a hazard our folks understand. They don't understand this over there now.
The Republicans are going to make a political issue out of it, every one of them, even Dirksen.
It's the only issue they got.
I talked to Dirksen the other day, Friday, and he suggested I have three of armed services and three from appropriations and three foreign, all of them foreign relations down. And I told him, all right, so I invited him. Yesterday before they came, he gave out a big statement that we had to get us a program and go after them. And Hickenlooper said that they just had to stand and show our force and put our men in there and let come what may come, and nobody disagreed with him. Now Mansfield, he just wants to pull up and get out. Morris wants to get out, and Greening wants to get out, and that's about where it stops. I don't know.
Well, there's others here that want to get out. They haven't said much about it, but Frank Church has told me two or three times that He didn't want to make a speech on it, but he just wished to God we could get out of there. I don't know whether he's told you that or not.
No, I haven't talked to him.
But I just use that as an illustration because he's mentioned it to me more than once. And,
who are the best people we have that you know of to talk to about this thing? I don't want to do anything on the basis of just the information I got now.
I don't know who, Mr. President.
I've talked to Eisenhower a little bit.
I think that the people that you have named have all formed a hard opinion on it. I think you could get
Rusk's,
make a survey.
Rusk has tried to pull back. He's tried to hold back on everything. But he's about come to the conclusion now that Laos is crumbling and Vietnam is wobbly.
Laos. Hell, it ain't worth a damn. They've been talking about all these battles down there, and I tried to get the best information I could from CIA and from Defense both on all this fierce fighting on the Plain of Jaws and all, and the highest estimate is to the casualties is 150. That lightly ocean thing is absolutely impossible. It's a whole lot worse than Vietnam. There are some of these Vietnamese, after they beat them over the head, it'll go in there and fight. But Laos is an impossible situation. That's just a rattle there. I don't know before I took any drastic action, I think I'd get somebody about like old Omar Bradley and one or two perhaps senior people who had had government experience, not necessarily military. If he wasn't scared to death of McNamara, this fella Adams, who's the head of strike, would be a top flight man to send out there with him. Let them go out there and fool around for a few days and smell the air and get the atmosphere and come back in and tell you what they think. Because they are new in it. They would not have a great many preconceived ideas in approaching it.
Now, one of our big problems there, Dick, the biggest between us, and I don't want this to repeat to anybody, is Lodge.
I know it.
He ain't worth a damn. He can't work with anybody.
Well, of course,
He won't let anybody else work. We get the best USIA man to put on all the radios and try to get him to be loyal to the government and he called in ESIA and said, I handle the newspapers, magazines, and radio myself, so to hell with you. So that knocks that guy out. Then we send out the best CIA man we got, and he said, I handle the intelligence, to hell with you. Then he wants a new deputy chief of mission. We get him to give us some names, and we pick one of those, the best one we got, send him out to run the damn war, and he gets where he won't speak to the deputy chief of mission. And we got General Harkins out there, and we thought he's a pretty good man. He gets where he can't work with him, so we send Westmoreland out. And it's just a hell of a mess, and you can't do anything with Lodge, and that's where McNamara is so frustrated. He goes out, and they get agreements, and he issues orders, and he sends stuff in there, and then Lodge takes charge of it himself, and he's not a take-charge man, and it just gets stacked up there.
He never has followed anything through to a conclusion since I've known him, and I've known him for 20-odd years. He never has. I went out with him around the world in 43, the only committee went out during the war. We went everywhere, and Lodge was on there. He's a bright fella, intelligent fella, but he's just not a man that persists. And he thinks he's dealing with barbarian tribes out there, that he's the emperor, and he's going to tell them what to do. Ain't a doubt in my mind that he had old Diem killed out there himself.
That was a tragic mistake, and it's awful, and we've lost everything.
You want to get somebody with more pliant to Lodge to do exactly what he said right quick. And he's living up on cloud nine. It's a bad mistake. I don't know. I think probably the best thing you could do would be to ask Lodge if he don't think he about time he's coming home.
Well, he'd be back home campaigning against us on this issue every day.
God Almighty, he's going to come back anyhow when time comes. I'd give him a reason for doing it. He's going to come back. If you bring him back now, everybody will say, well, hell, he's mad because Johnson removed him out there. MacArthur couldn't, with all of his power, hurt Truman because everybody would have said, well, hell, he's just mad because he got removed. And the old million sympathized with him in it. And you need to worry. Lodge will be in here. In my judgment, he'll be on that ticket in some way. I don't think I nominated him for president, but they may put him on there for vice president. Whether they do or don't, he'll be back here campaigning for that campaign's over. I don't know. They better take that back. This thing is so hopeless for the Republicans. I just doubt that he certainly got enough political sense to know that and not get his head chopped off in a perfectly foolish show.
Has Clay got any judgment on a thing like this? His experience?
Yes, he has. Yeah, he has, but though he's inclined to...
He's the other area of the world, though, mostly, isn't he?
I think Clay has... He knows... I'd take his judgment on most anything if he'd separate himself from his predilections, and he don't have any out in that part of the world. I think people generally have got a good deal of respect for Clay's judgment, too. And there's a great deal of affection and respect for old man Bradley. He's not in his dotage yet by a hell of a lot. I got him up here the other day getting some advice from him on some matters, and I found him very alert. He's so humble, I don't know. He'd just be a doormat for Lodge out there. But he's an intelligent man. Now, Clay wouldn't. Clay will he'd stand up to anybody if he feels like he'd got any support from higher places. I just don't know. It's a tragic situation. It's just one of those places where you can't win. Anything you do is wrong.
Well, think about it. Call me.
All right, sir. I thought about it. I have worried about it. And I have prayed about it.
I don't believe we can do anything.
Like religiously, I have, because it's something that frightens me, because it's my country's involved over there. And if we get into there on any considerable scale, there's no doubt in my mind of what the Chinese will be in there. And there we'd be fighting a dang conventional war against our secondary, potential threat. And it'd be a Korea on a much bigger scale and a worse scale, because the peculiar physical configuration of Korea made extensive guerrilla fighting impossible. But that's not true over there. If you go from Laos and Cambodia and Vietnam and bring North Vietnam into it too, it's the damnedest mess on earth. They lost 250,000 men and spent a couple billion of their money and 2 billion of ours down there. And just got the hell whipped out of them, and they had the best troops they had, including practically a division of crack German troopers who were starving and enlisted in the Foreign Legion went down there.
You don't have any doubt, but what if we go in there and get them up against the wall, the Chinese communists going to come in?
There's no doubt about it.
That's my judgment, and our people don't think so.
There's no doubt in my mind about it. You'll find Chinese volunteers in there as soon as you get, very shortly after we have active combat units engaged.
Now, Mike writes me a memo, and all he says is that we continue to support the Vietnamese, and that's number one. An end to the reflex of peak and face saving at every essay of De Gaulle's. Well, we've not peaked. We just asked De Gaulle to give us a blueprint, and he don't have it. He just says neutralization, but ain't nobody wants to agree to neutralization. And we ask him who'll agree, go with old Ben Milam. We're ready, but he just says, well, we have to continue to maintain our strength and get in a position. But he's got no blueprint. Three, a realistic facing the fact that we're in this situation without reliable military allies. Well, I know that. Four, an exploration of the possibility of the United Nations or some other arrangement. Well, this is Mike Mansfield, and they won't do a damn thing, even on the Cambodia border. We can't get a majority vote in the Security Council. A willingness to entertain any reasonable proposals for international conferences. Well, we are ready to confer with anybody any time, but the conferences ain't going to do a damn bit of good. They ain't going to take back and give us territory and behave. We tell them every week. We tell Khrushchev. We send China and Hanoi and all of them word that we'll get out of there and stay out of there if they'll just quit raiding their neighbors, and they just say, screw you.
That's right.
So the conferences won't do it. Now, the whole question, as I see it, is it more dangerous for us to let things go as they're going now, deteriorating every day,
I don't think we can let it go, Mr. President, indefinitely. Like
then it would be for us to move in.
We either got to move in or move out.
That's about what it is.
Your future. You can make a tremendous case for moving out.
You take the Nixon.
Good one for moving in, but
Nixon, Rockefeller
would be more consistent with the attitude of American people and their general reactions to go in, because they could understand that. But getting out, even after we go in and get bogged down in there with the war with China, would be it's going to be a hell of a mess. It'd be worse than we are now.